It has been a little hard to find distribution for this movie in America. It was made in 2009, and this is the first time. Thanks for all of you to come out. We have the cameraman is here, Wolfgang. Could you get up quickly? Cameraman Wolfgang Lena. He's been living in Brooklyn for what, 10 years now, I think? Then we have George Salmas, who helped us with he was the music supervisor. George, he came all the way from Tennessee. George Salmas, all good tonight. And who else is here? We have Brian Beckers, who helped us with the PR, got us connected with the ECNOW people. Brian. And then my dear friend Didi Hanek is here, who made me start doing movies, really. And Didi for all your support. Then we have Marcus Weiland, my partner and producer, is here. Marcus. Hey. And he's selling the DVDs at the table. Oh, here he is, over there. Okay. Then we have, from Red Hook, there's Stash. You recognize me with the song? Red Hook, and there's Mel, I can see. I mean, there's a few people here. I don't know if anybody wants to get up. Buddha, where's Buddha? Buddha's in the film. Buddha! There's a lot of people here who support this. Thank you all for doing this with us. Anybody who has ever been in the documentary maybe knows how boring it is to do this. Okay, and about me. Well, I've lived in New York for 15 years and I moved away in 2004 and continued my work in Vienna. I used to do a hip-hop radio show very early on from New York for Austrian state radio, back when not many people played hip-hop on the radio. I started in the 90s. Everybody who was anybody in New York was on my show. Then I heard this radio show on Columbia. That's how long I know Bobito. I came to interview you guys, remember? No? And then in 2001, I did my first film, which was a prison documentary, Too Soon for Sorry. And I did a film about, I was always interested in the subject of branding, consumerism. I did a film called Knock Off. I did a film about the guy who invented the shopping mall, which was an Austrian architect in 2004, I think. And I've been continuing doing radio documentary work, and right now I'm working on a radio documentary for German public radio about the racism in these elections right now. That's a little bit about me.
Great. Thank you. Peace. My name is Bobby Kavosi, a.k.a. Cool Bob Love. Very happy to be a part of this Q&A today. I'm currently co-directing a documentary that will be out this summer called Doing It in the Park. Pick Up Basketball NYC. Also published and authored a book in 2003 called Where'd You Get Those? New York City Sneaker Culture, 1960 to 1987. Wow. I was also the voice on NBA Street Volume 2, Volume 3 video game, and I played ball against Carl Sanders a couple of times in my life, too.
Thank you. Carl Sanders, first I want to thank my basketball players, my high school basketball team is here. The girls' basketball team is here. We have people from Grady, the staff that I work with, thanks for coming out and supporting me. And could never forget, never turn my back on my neighborhood. My guys from my neighborhood, let's give it up for them. Carl Sanders, where do I start? Former student athlete, played basketball for a long time, did a lot of great things with the ball. Opened up, was an outlet for me to indulge in different things and get involved in a lot of different things. And I try to give that back to the kids that I'm around every day. I try to affect them positively. So we run a community program, youth program. We've been doing that for about 8-9 years now since I got out of college. And also we do a lot of books and basketball programs throughout the winter where kids come to community centers. And we help them out, and we gotta, you know, and them are the guys that take their time out and do that. So thanks to them, you know, putting in the time and the energy when I'm doing other things. So that's a good thing. We put this project together around, I want to say 2006, 2007, and it was just this chapter of our life, you know, things that we were going through, and like you see, they featured some of the things that I went through in high school. But it was a chapter in our life. It was some great times. You know, we were trying to figure out what was our next move. And that's what y'all guys just saw. So, you know, we're going to continue to stay positive. We got a lot of great things coming. And hopefully, we have everybody's support. Thanks again for supporting.
Okay, so one of my questions is, as a documentary filmmaker, and when I'm looking at content, I'm looking at programs, I'm always wondering, how do the filmmakers get access to their subjects? And so how did you connect with Carl? Carl, how did you perceive her? Because also, you're a white woman coming into a black man's game. So how was that received? How did you make those connections? Because as we see in the documentary, you had incredible access to everybody in there. And it seems like they opened up themselves to you. How did that happen?
Well, I think in documentary making, it's mostly about time. I started researching this subject actually when I did this prison documentary, which was also first done for radio. And then I filmed in several different prisons in the whole country. And through my radio work, where you only come with a microphone, you get in touch with people, you really get to know people, and then you kind of open up the doors to come later with a crew, with a camera. And I had that experience in my prison documentary a lot, and then my editor at German TV Arte said, you should do something about sneakers, because there's such a connection between the image of black males being criminals on the one hand, but these superstars on the other hand, and it's really kind of tied in this one object, the phone pilot. So she actually had that suggestion. And then I went and did a great documentary called Sports and Race, which was mostly done around this basketball court, The Hole. You know, The Hole, and what is it, Bed-Stuy? Is it in Bed-Stuy?
In The Hole.
So, yeah. I originally had planned to do it with people out there, and that didn't work out. And then I, you know, through somebody told me about Carl's great work as a community leader, which I thought was very interesting, that somebody would be a player and do so much in the community. He introduced us, George Kalimba, right?
Yeah, George.
George Littlejohn.
George Littlejohn.
Yeah. That's how I met him, and then maybe he can tell the story from there.
Yeah. Carl, how did you receive Katharina when she came in with this idea if she wanted to do a story on you and your crew?
Well, at first, we was looking at it, this is a great opportunity for us. You know, we were doing a lot of things, we don't have no support. So from a business side of it, we was like, you know, this would be perfect for us, get involved with her, you know. And, you know, we think, oh, wow, we can get a lot of advice. She's a white lady, you know, she knows a lot. We could probably rub some good things to rub off on her. So from that angle, and then, you know, I'm hanging out with a lot of guys that weren't doing a lot of great things. And then we started thinking she was a cop because she started asking so many questions. You know, we was like, wow, she's getting a little bit too nosy. But on the serious side, you know, we just saw that it was something that could give our story, things that we were doing, you know, it would put it out there. It would hopefully put it out there. You know, stuff like this. This was our dream that it would reach this potential. That our message would get out there, because we were doing things when there were no cameras around, when nobody was looking, because we were doing it from the heart. So we thought it was a great opportunity.
And did you have to sell anybody else to allow her to come in and film them? Did you have to convince them to open up to her, or did they?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, a couple of guys, like I said, they weren't doing the greatest things in life. So, you know, they definitely didn't need no cameras. They definitely wanted to be on film. And I had to convince them to, you know, ease up and let's just do this. It's just worth it. That's what I just put in their head. It's worth it for the long run. So,
all right, great.
Yeah.
Great. And how did you connect with the folks in Ghana? And why did you take that trip to Ghana?
Well, also, just one more thing. We shot here for 2 summers, and from the first summer, we almost used none of the footage because the second year was so much stronger. And from that experience, I really know that time is so important. If people know you, you can tell such a different story. That, I mean, most people who do this kind of work just mostly rush in, rush out, especially in places like Windhoek, where there's so much, sensationalist journalism coming in. I remember there was one lady from the New York Times one day, you know, and the kind of questions they ask, and how do you go in there, get their image and their stereotypes, their cliches, and go out again. There's so little earnest work being done to portray people, you know, in neighborhoods like in Red Hook, I think. So the second summer we had much better access, I felt, that people really understood where we were coming from and why we were doing this. And then in Ghana, it was even harder because I had a very young daughter at the time, so I couldn't really go much to do this kind of thorough research. So actually my brother went there to spend a few weeks there, and he found this great female player, and I really wanted to include more women in this very male world. And as you can see, there's a lot of support for female players there. So we had this great woman that we were going to portray, and then 3 weeks before we started shooting, she was actually hired by the military, so she couldn't work with us. So we had to, you know, end up with a guy, which is good too. But so there, the biggest problem I had there, and I would even say that I wouldn't do this again, and I would not really want to work under these circumstances in a poor part of Africa again, is because you show up with a camera and people have these incredible expectations that you're going to change their lives. And so many of these people kept calling us for years if we can get them out of there somehow. So you have such a responsibility. And I had letters, like leaflets printed out that I gave to people that said, nothing is going to change in your life if you are in this film. There's no way, this is not going to be even shown in Ghana. This is just, like, I tried to make it clear that there shouldn't be any hopes. I can only tell the story, but I can't change their circumstances at all. I paid everybody a little bit for their time, but you know, this is a very small budget film, so that was tough, I would say. Also, I wasn't able to even go there for a screening, you know. I mean, I sent DVDs, but there was no public screening ever there. This is a very low budget operation with public money from Europe, and you know, I mean, we lost a lot of money on this film, so we're a very small production company. I make my money doing radio. This is a labor of love. So it's so hard to get any pictures like this out of a place like Ghana. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Because I mean, anything that's not superficial, you know.
Right.
And then to not come in with a camera and mess up people's minds is really difficult.
So let me add on, this is actually a question for the panel. And you hit upon something that there are huge expectations in Ghana when somebody comes in with a camera. And I also think that there are huge expectations here in the U.S. in regards to, you know, whether or not you're going to follow basketball, you're going to be a basketball player, and what are those expectations? How do you moderate those expectations as a leader, as a community leader? How do you moderate those expectations of the young people when they come to you and they're like, I'm going to be the next Iverson, I'm going to be the next, you know, and you know the reality is it's like one in practically a gazillion people who are going to actually make it. How do you work through that? What is your tactic on that?
I mean, basically through failure. And when I say through failure, I mean, there's so many of us that fail at trying to do that we have the experience to go back and, you know, not kill their dreams, but also express the bumps in the road, like we always say. And, you know, like I could be, like, I deal with that every day because I got my high school basketball team here. Then we have 10-year-olds, we have 11-year-olds, and, you know, like just the other day we was going to the Nets game. So we give them a look at it, you know, because we want to inspire their dreams. But we also give them the reality that, you know, they are, you know, because we around them so much that we see the patterns that they start to build, and we see if they're getting off track or if they're still on track. And we express to them that, you know, our failures and the things that we did are reasons why we didn't go further or maximize our potential. So we give them both ends. You're going to fail. You could fail if you don't continue to do the right things and be focused and be disciplined. And it's very hard to do, and there's very few of us that's going to make it. But if you do stay on the right path, there is success for you. Maybe not the NBA, maybe something else. I got an opportunity to play in Dominican Republic. I got an opportunity to play in ABA for a couple of years. It wasn't the NBA, but it still was professional basketball. I still got an opportunity to live out some of my dreams. So I always inspire them, but I also keep the reality involved where, you know, let's make sure we get our college degree so that we have a backup plan. But don't stop dreaming. Every day we keep dreaming. You know, so.
And basically, the great thing about basketball is that as a participatory recreation, it helps a lot of people stay out of trouble. And that's actually Dr. James Naismith in 1891. He invented the sport not to be coached, not to be pro leagues, not to be anything else, but to give people something to, it was like spiritual athletics for him. That was his invention. That was his vision. So it's beautiful when kids, adults, you know, anyone aspires to high goals, whether or not they meet them or not, they're still at a good place. I was fortunate enough to do clinics in West Africa through a program called SEEDS Academy, which stands for Sports Education and Economic Development in Senegal. I've also done clinics in Zimbabwe and South Africa. So when I saw the film, it really touched a nice place in my heart because I've been on the courts where you see people playing barefooted. You see some of the kids playing with, you know, the sneakers all, you know, holes. And, you know, the great thing about sneakers for them, though, it helps them. Like, for example, there's an organization called Hoops for Hope that I've done a lot of work, nonprofit work with. They use sneakers and basketball as a draw to the kids in the community to teach them about life skills, HIV prevention. And so even though these kids might initially come there thinking, I want to play in the NBA, I want to get out of my, you know, out of my country and try to earn a decent living, still there's good ancillary benefits out of basketball or out of the draw of sneakers even. And a lot of countries in Africa, like I've done a lot of donating over the years, and a sneaker that's lightly worn here in the United States can go out there and be worn for 4 years and then pass down to his little brother. And his little brother wear for 4 years and he'll pass it down. And a sneaker can actually last for 8 to 12 years. Sneakers that we think, you know, cats are like sneakerheads, are disposable basically. So it's really amazing. And if any of you, I mean, you know, I watched this film, I've been very involved in New York City basketball for many years. Any of you interested, after seeing this film, being inspired to help and actually be active in sneaker donating, there's three great websites. There's hoopsafrica.org, there's Soul for Souls, that's S-O-L-E, 4, and then S-O-U-L-S, and also samaritansfeet.org. All three of them send over 10,000 sneakers to Africa and other developing countries in South America annually. And you can be a part of it. There's probably a lot of sneakers in your closet right now that could be used greatly by somebody overseas. And then even within, you know, there's a lot of issues that you and your man, I love your man, I forgot. Is he here? The dude that was crazy grumpy, like, yo. And I'm not an employee of Nike. I have done work with them over the years. What I will say about that, though, is that there are brands here that have donated and contributed a lot of money towards marketing. But the side benefit of that is encourage a lot of people, inspire a lot of people to play basketball. And whether or not they get a free pair of sneakers or whether they got, you know, the support for their tournament or for their camp, it's got people playing, participating, being healthy, and there's a lot of good that happens for the community out of that. So anyway, I don't mean to be all long-winded. I have a film coming out called Doing in the Park, Pick Up Basketball, NYC. That's my little plug. We explore a little bit of that, the beauty of that essence in our film, be on the lookout for it. I have flies with me too, if y'all want to see that. All right, please.
Always got a plug, that's a good thing. All right, I think we can take some questions from the audience. Does anybody have a question that they'd like to ask?
Since 2009. have the open basketball games and people looking. Is that still there?
We definitely continue to work in Red Hook. I mean, it's a lot of great things that's coming around on the perimeter of Red Hook, but that's the perimeter. You know, it's a Fairway and IKEA, but that's the outside. And the inside, things are pretty much the same. So, you know, we still do our annual Paradise Classic, something that actually my pops is here. And this is something that my father started in 1989. It's pretty much my father. And if it wasn't for my father, you know, I just want to, you know, let him know that, you know, you greatly appreciate it. And if it wasn't for him, not only for me, you know, but he helped a lot of people in the community. And I'm just pretty much riding his coattail and doing the things that he did. Thank you guys for that. But we still got the Paradise Classic. We still do that every year. We still committed to the community. And we do that usually the first or second week in August. Everybody's invited. Free food, free entertainment, a great time. And we also have a tournament now that we're doing currently with Carmelo Anthony. It's called Brother Melo. So if you're ever at home, just check out some of our YouTubes and just check out some of the things that we continue to do. Brother Melo, Paradise Classic, still in. All right?
I can say when we were making our film, we went out to Red Hook a couple of times. And there was a Saturday morning, Sunday morning, there were like 200 kids out there from all over Brooklyn, kids from uptown. Lloyd Daniels is out there, playground legend, coaching his own son. Real beautiful scene to be supported in Red Hook, Henry Street, right? Yeah, like that court. I got to play one-on-one against you over there. That's your home court.
Can we have time for about one or two more questions?
Yeah. This is a question for Carl. A small one for Katharina. When you saw the film, the completed film, and the connection between Red Hook and Ghana, and using basketball as a method to connect the two, did that change you in any way, your perspective? What did you feel about that? And then for Katharina, what's the takeaway objective of the film? Was your message met? Why did you do it? Why did you do the film? What's the takeaway?
That's always so hard to answer. First of all, I've lived here on the Lower East Side for 15 years and I just fell in love with this game. I could never stop when I walked by West 4th Street and somebody played. I was always late to anything I was going to. I just think it's an incredible art form. And I came here because of music, because I did a music radio show. And to me, this game is so musical. It's to me, it's like watching, you know, a dance, a ballet, whatever. It's just. I also really love watching girls play basketball. So it was not just about that. In a way, I think my interest was in what I saw going on in American prisons. And I really tried to find out, as a European, you know, you come here and then, you know, there's racism and stuff. But then I went to this prison out in Jersey, and it's a huge prison. It's this old building from like 1900 or something. And I went there because there was remember that hip-hop group that was signed by Disney, and they were Lifers, the Lifers group. I went there to interview the Lifers group, Hollywood Basic, yeah. And they took me into this prison, and there's a huge, like, you go in and it's a cage. You are inside the cage, and the inmates are kind of like outside the cage, like looking down to you. And suddenly I saw it was all African Americans, and I was in shock. I did not expect that at all. I had no clue, I was totally naive. I knew through hip-hop what was going on, kind of, in the streets. But to find out how many African-Americans are incarcerated in this country, I was just literally... I did the interviews with the Lifers group. People who are great guys, all in there for life. They were 15, 16, 18. Or maybe 15 is exaggerating, but... I went home. I had such a migraine, I started throwing up for hours. I was so sick. It was like... this day, I can't believe what I saw there, you know? And then I guess I started taking it from there. And for me, what I took away is that I think this is a disaster, you know, what's going on here. And it has so much to do with the stuff that is being sold in the world. It's all African-American. The music, the coolness of, you know, anything, the clothes, the sneakers. It's all being sold through mostly black males between the ages of 16 and, I don't know, you know, whatever. Movies, film stars, the president, you know, everybody's cool. Everything's cool, but I mean, how many people in the Red Hook projects have jobs? And how many people end up in prison? And then people got incarcerated while we were filming for nothing. The policing of these neighborhoods, all these stories are just, to me, coming from a very safe European background, you know, being an academic originally. It was just really heavy. And I don't think that, I mean, there's a reason why work like this is not being shown in America. There's a reason why the things I know about the mass incarceration is not in the news here. I think, I mean, I always thought this is gonna explode, but the 15 years I've lived here, it didn't. And I don't see it explode now. It's almost like the fact that you have a black president now is like putting the lid on things, you know. Well, I don't know if that answered your question.
Yeah. could you say the question again?
So after you saw the film, right, the completed version, and you saw the kids in Africa on the court, and then you looked at the big picture, did it affect you in any way? Do you see yourself differently? How do you communicate to the community group, or does it not matter?
It definitely matters. I mean, it didn't affect me as far as, like, you know, something that I was, you know, thrown back from, because I pretty much expected it from just knowing a little of my past history about it. So, you know, like, when you look at it, you know, they got their struggles and we got our struggles. I think a lot of our struggles are more mental. A lot of their struggles are physical. You know, they don't have sneakers. We got sneakers. You know, they don't have clothes. We usually have clothes. You know, you may go there and there's beautiful people. You come to Red Hook and there's animals. You know, and not saying that that is not beautiful people in Red Hook, but the mentality. You know, everybody's for themselves, you know, and it goes back to what Katharina said about being incarcerated. You know, pretty much the struggle in Red Hook is trying to keep, you know, fathers from being in jail. Then, you know, and being at work, you know, and probably theirs is a totally different story. You know, the family's intact, but they just don't have no money. They just don't have no ways of providing or getting money. But, you know, like I said, you know, from their situation to our situation, we both got struggles. And we're still trying to figure out our struggles in the community of Red Hook and all the communities all over Brooklyn, Manhattan, wherever, the five boroughs. And things are probably still tough out there in Africa. So, you know, if I'm answering your question, I think, you know, the struggle is still there. You know, we're still fighting. That's why we continue to do work. We continue to try to educate the minds. Because if we can educate the minds, we can help them in the future. So that's my answer to that.
All right, I've been given the time. We need to wrap up. But I want to thank Katharina, Babito, and Carl for coming out and sharing your wonderful film with us. And everybody should keep coming back for the rest of the film festival. It's going on for another till Monday. So come on out and support Act Now Foundation. Thank you.